to our satsang, Christ Clarity Satsang. Our new subscribers, the viewers, appreciate everyone, appreciate the feedback, and we're trying to push things forward as fast as possible. July 12th, 2012, right now. Keep in mind that we're used to thinking of change as something pretty steady, and we overlook the fact that change itself changes. The rate of change changes here too. And if we can just see that, allow that to be considered, that change doesn't always remain in steady state. Not at all. We're used to, you know, the sun being the same, orbiting around the sun being the same, the length of days being the same, the seasons being the same, a lot of things being the same. And yet there's a lot of change taking place in the world that is accelerating, decelerating. It's not stable at all. So it's very, very possible that the rate of change is going to change drastically very soon, which is why we are trying so hard to do our very best here and push forward the highest concepts, belief, and faith towards that which can free us from this drastic change that is coming. Change often means loss in this world. And in fact, this entire existence that we think we're experiencing is actually based on loss. Okay, it is its purpose is to present a picture of loss. So we will always do that, sometimes more so than others. Coming up very soon, it will be a picture of severe loss. In many, many, many different ways, people will simply think that they're losing everything. Not enough just now to lose your life. You know, that's pretty simple. No. The loss that is coming up now is way, way deeper than that. Before people lose their lives around this planet, they're going to go through drastic losses in all sorts of different ways. And once they've gone through all this loss, as much as possible, only then probably will they lose their lives, the body. But psychologically, emotionally, mentally, belief-wise, faith-wise, concept-wise, they will have feel like as if they've lost everything. Why? Because the goal of existence is to lose everything. Believing that if we lose everything, we'll be reborn as a new being. And we'll be the ones, we'll be prime creators, we will transcend what we have been and become something greater. But first we have to get rid of what we are. So this whole dream of existence is an attempt to get rid of what we really are. What we really are is spirit, created by the prime creator, eternal, invulnerable, everlasting, infinitely creative, able to flow with infinitely rich experiencing, completely free of conflict, fear, vulnerability. That's what we are. We're trying to lose that, forget about it, lose it, so that we can be greater than that, because we can be prime creators. So we are dreaming this dream of loss. We feel that the loss becomes complete, total, that what we are will have be no more. And then something else will arise from the ashes, like a phoenix will arise from the ashes of perfect loss. And we will be this new prime creator, new reality. We'll be able to define reality the way we want it to be. So, from time to time, we press this issue of loss, and we want to try and lose everything. And we're coming up upon one of these times where we want to try and lose everything. It's not only enough for us to lose everything. We want everyone else to lose everything. That's the ego. That's the goal. Everyone lose everything. Okay, lose. I mean, you can just talk about loss on all different levels. The physical, material. You lose your job. You lose your savings. You lose your retirement. You lose your home. Okay? You lose your health. You lose your friends. You lose a place where you used to be. You lose your food. You lose your utilities. You lose your shelter. You know, you lose your health, evidently. You lose your happiness. You lose your security. You lose your feeling of trust. You lose your stability. You lose your composure. You lose your concentration. You lose your hope. You lose all of that first, you see, and then finally, you know, your health gets bad enough where you lose your breath. Okay, lose your breath as well. And we're already, you know, starting down that slope pretty heavy right now. It's been an enormous amount of loss taking place in the world already, right? We tend to think, well, maybe that's it. No, that's just getting started. Just getting started here. And we don't dwell on it so much. The media doesn't talk about it that much and dwell on it. There are documentaries about people and all that they've lost. And to point it out to people and say, hey folks, there are millions upon millions who are just losing everything. They're experiencing this free fall of loss. And eventually it's going to get to everybody. And eventually the entire world will be just this tragic picture of extreme loss. Why are we in this scenario? Because we are aware that there is a way to avoid this, to escape this. There's a remedy, there's an option right here. And we are focusing on that option. Because really, we don't particularly want to be dragged through the loss that this world is hell-bent on. So many different ways. Very self-destructive stage right now on this planet. Because this is simply a dance of existence. That's what existence does. It's very self-destructive existence. Its purpose is to destroy the self. That's its very purpose of existence. Symbolically, of course. But we think if we just destroy all symbols, that somehow that little magical effect on reality and reality will disappear. Of course, that's just, you know, magical belief. It won't happen. But we believe it'll happen, so we continue on with this symbolic sacrifice. The universe is a sacrificial machine. It's all symbolic. Energy is actually symbolic of essence. Matter is symbolic also of essence. It's all of this is symbolic of reality, which is idea and essence and being. It's just a way to symbolize it so we can then destroy, use all these symbols, or try to, and believe that we are somehow getting close to getting rid of reality so that we can be prime creators. It was just a silly idea we had. There's nothing profound about this idea at all. Nothing. We just felt like, hey, why not? Let's just do something really stupid and see if we can be prime creators. And we didn't realize that this dream of loss would arise and we'd be so taken up with it. But we have. We've been taken up by very, very bad. Fearful of all of the loss of these symbols, thinking that there's something profound that will cause ourselves to be destroyed. And believing that, well, if we just go along with it, that we'll be destroyed, but then we'll be reborn. It's all a waste of time. It's all folly. It's all foolish. It's useless. It's impossible. And it's all suffering and misery and terror and fear. And we don't want that. We're entitled to live free of fear. We are literally entitled to live under the laws and rules of God, the Prime Creator, which means we're entitled to reality. We're entitled to be completely free of loss, free of fear, free of doubt, free of confusion, free of vulnerability. We're absolutely entitled to that. So we are simply insisting on what we're entitled to, which is to experience freedom from loss. But we sure won't get that as we remain in this world, as our experiencing is primarily focused on this world, as our awareness, as our belief and faith is focused on this world, we will experience and see freedom from loss. We will be seeing constant loss. Let me see if I can. So what we're trying to do is claim our inheritance. Okay, claim our inheritance, which is to experience a world that is free of loss. Just claiming our inheritance. What we're entitled to. As the constant cycles of existence continue to take place ceaselessly here, and yet the rate of those cycles changing and shifting all the time. Sometimes slow change, sometimes fast change. We're at the time now called the Kali Yuga, you know, very dark time where change can, where loss can be very drastic, amazingly drastic. So drastic that we're caught by surprise because we've been used to a slow rate of change, punctuated by drastic change like the bubonic plague, the Black Death, Spanish influenza, the cholera epidemics, the smallpox epidemics, the great famines of India and China, the great tsunamis, the volcanic eruptions in prehistoric time. There's been a lot of drastic situations, severe earthquakes and floods. So those are punctuate the normal kind of slow rate of change that we're used to. So we've gone through a period now of pretty slow-paced change, suddenly punctuated by things like the tsunamis and various troubles we've had here this world. Wars, of course, come about, and great severe displacement, severe loss, all of this. And yet, we still think that things are going to kind of be manageable. But they're not. There's a point where loss gets out of control, and it's no longer manageable. It's like we say, we jump the shark. Once we jump the shark, you know, we're in trouble. Big trouble. And we are most certainly doing our very best to jump on that shark. I mean, the world is. It's telling us not to jump on that shark. In fact, to jump out of even the possibility of jumping that shark. We want to grab hold, not of a shark, but of a divine fish. I had a dream just recently, and I was looking up from the ground here. I had a house here, looking up to the blue sky, and out of the blue sky, I saw this very calm blue fish with beautiful markings, white markings on it, come swimming down through the sky, like as if the sky were water, and it swam by me. Very slowly, and suddenly I had the feeling like I needed to grab hold of the fish's tail. So I sort of lunged out and grabbed the fish's tail, like this, and the fish kept swimming, and it pulled me up into the sky. It was softly, gently swimming through the sky, and I was just holding onto the fish. Like, this fish was not a shark, it was a very benign fish. So, I would say that we need to jump that fish. Maybe it's the Mahapalash. We could jump the Mahapalani and let that Mahapalani fish take us up into the celestial realms, as it were. Because the world is jumping the shark. Absolutely jumping the shark. But we have options. We really have options. Even though it may seem kind of drastic. Now, I have said that there is a behind this world, there's a real world. There's a loss-free world. And the light of that loss-free world can become apparent to us when we make that our sole purpose to experience that. And we have all sorts of ways we might symbolize that. Dreams might symbolize it as the Mahapalani fish comes and we grab a hold of it and it takes us up, in, you know, up into the sky like that. These are very powerful dreams, symbolizing something extraordinary. Because what we are in reality is zero loss. Nothing is ever lost in reality. That is what we were created that way. So of course we're pre-qualified to experience free of loss. Of course we're pre-qualified to experience a loss-free world. And it's no surprise that me or you or anyone else would experience this. The only surprise there would be is the fact that there is a loss-free world, because we don't see it. You know, we look around, where is it? High and low and over here and over there. We don't see any loss-free world. Everywhere we look, you know, there's constant loss taking place. That's because it's our purpose to see loss. And we continue to see loss when we believe that we can change loss. That we can have our cake and eat it too. We will continue to see loss if we think that we can somehow gradually transform this planet. Or even quickly transform it. All talk of transforming this world, this planet, that's exactly what prevents us from seeing the loss-free world. Because if we were to see the loss-free world shining in immaculate innocence, untouched by loss of any kind ever, you can realize everything there, nothing there has ever experienced loss. And I've had a glimpse of this world, so I know it does exist, it is real. And I looked about and I realized there's nothing that's ever experienced any loss, and it dawned on me. I said, oh my gosh, what is this place? I got kind of, you know, a little bit jittery. If we experience a world that has no loss, then where is the transformation that we think we're supposed to be bringing about? There's no opportunity for transformation, is there? So we think that we have the power to change loss into loss, to transform it. Just as we believe that we have the power to transform ourselves into something greater than what we are, transform spirit into prime creator. Cause and effect are one. And the effect of a cause is one with the cause, one with the purpose of the cause. So our purpose was, the cause of existence is to project this scenario of loss that we would forget what we are and ultimately try to lose what we are. That's his purpose. If we were to be able to transform the effects of this cause, we'd essentially be separating cause and effect. We wouldn't be changing the cause, we'd be simply changing the effects. So here we are in this world, working at the level of effects, thinking we can change the effects and keep the cause the same. And if we could do that, that would essentially mean that we would be able to separate from what caused us and choose for us to be whatever we want to be. It would no longer be one with the cause, what caused us, and share the same purpose. Share that one purpose. We would no longer do that. So here we are trying to transform the world. Of course we see it's a place of conflict and strife and war and all these problems and loss. And here we are doing our utmost to focus on this world and find what we can fix, find what we can make better, see what we can transform. And believing that at some point, if we all just work in the right direction, we'll be able to transform this world. And so, of course, we need to look upon that which needs transforming, don't we? If our purpose is to transform, is to heal, don't we have to see that which needs transforming? If we want to heal, don't we have to see that which is sick? If we have to change something, don't we have to see, look upon that which we want to change, that needs changing as far as we're concerned? If we want to fix something, don't we have to see that which is broken, that needs fixing? Now, if we see a loss-free world, we've never experienced any loss of any kind, how can we look on this world and still harbor the desire to transform, to fix, to change, to heal? How can we have both of those, all of that? You know, the saying we hear so often is that, you know, we can have it all. You hear that? We can have it all. But can we really have it? Can we really have it all? Can we have the purpose and desire to transform, fix, heal, change, and at the same time look upon an immaculate, pure world where there's never been any loss of any kind is exactly what we want. It's perfect for us. Can we have both of those? No, what would happen if we did look upon that such a world? What would happen is we would feel completely conflicted, and we'd feel like we're going crazy, like we're being attacked, like we're going insane. It would be horrible. It would like be a hellish experience. So those who have this profound need, the desire to transform, to change, to fix, to heal, to integrate, to harmonize, to unify, and all of that, how can they look upon a world that needs none of that? That feels absolutely flawless and perfect to us, and it's always been flawless and perfect, and always will be, and cannot be changed in any way. How can we experience that, and at the same time experience this tremendous desire and carry out all this change, harmonizing, unifying, fixing, healing, all that, transforming? How can we have it both? Satsang is just to point out we cannot have both of that simultaneously. We'd feel as if we're going completely insane. When I saw the real world, the world that's free of loss, I start getting jittery, you know, and I thought, whoa, you know, wait a minute, what was I thinking? What caused me to get kind of jittery? Well, I was thinking, how can I explain this to those who are all into unification, harmonization, transformation, healing, fixing, and changing and all of that? So how can I present this and talk about it, and for myself be free of all these desires, and can I have it both, you know? And I said, wow, I got some things I need to consider here. But then satsang is all about doing this consideration, and then coming to the conclusion that, you know, it's impossible, we cannot have both, right? We can't have two ideas that are mutually exclusive. One that it insists on loss, and one that is no loss. One that insists on changing, fixing, unifying, harmonizing, healing, making some sort of change, and at the same time experience that which is changeless. We would feel so conflicted with that. And so, of course, we continue to see this world. Who continues to see it? Even those who are speaking the language, spiritual language of unification, harmonization, bringing about oneness, bringing about peace, bringing about happiness, bringing about joy, bringing about good relationships, loving relationships, transforming the economic system, transforming the world, making it a utopia, change, 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 healing, 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 healing all the sicknesses, fixing all the broken spirits and souls and disappointments and bitterness, fixing, change, all that stuff. And it sounds so great, but keep in mind, the price that you pay for this is to continue to see a world where all that needs to take place. Where all that needs to take place severely. Often those people who have these strong, strong desires find themselves in places that are truly horrible. So why? So that their desires seem completely justified. This is a secret, right? I'm telling you the real secret. The more you want to harmonize and unify and change and transform and bring peace and love and understanding, and freedom from want, freedom from scarcity, freedom from suffering, heal all illnesses, heal all mental problems, everything, the more you insist that this is your mission in life, the more you are going to find yourself in places where all that is extremely necessary. You're going to find yourself in hell, in other words. Because only in that hell could you feel that your purpose is justified. Hold on to this and say, yeah, you see, my desire to do all this is totally justified, because look at all these broken spirits and broken bodies and hellish problems. That's why you see these do-gooders who have this, you know, tremendous desire. You see them in an earthquake ravaged Haiti, in other words, where it's just monstrous, the human suffering. And there they are, and they're just immersed in all this death and dying and sickness and horrible situations of sickness and scarcity and depravity and crime and a need for transformation and change. For them, it's like, this is like heaven, you know. Say, oh, they're saying, thank you, God, for giving me the opportunity to serve. I'm not making light of the suffering. I'm pointing out to you the facts of the situation. They literally, in their hearts, are just so full of gratitude. They'll say, oh, because they're, but they're really saying, oh, my gosh, what if I lived in a place that was perfect, flawless? I didn't need to, you know, do any of this stuff. They'd say, oh, I'm so afraid of that because I'm not a good enough person yet. I want to be able to serve. I want to be able to transform. I want to be able to change. And here God has given me this great opportunity, this horrible earthquake and all these poor people suffering like crazy. And I could go in there and help them out. And it's custom made for those attitudes. And the people doing it are the people who have this most intense desire to transform, change, heal, fix, soothe, relieve, bless, unify, harmonize, etc., distribute, get rid of misery and suffering, transform the world, and here's their chance. They feel so blessed that they've been given this chance. And yet here we are in satsang, and I'm this satsang is coming from a place here that is very beautiful, very peaceful, with very little scarcity, very little crime, you know, minimal sickness and suffering, problems, etc. Kind of almost, you know, one of the more ideal places on the planet. And I'm saying that this itself is not nearly good enough. What we really need to do is see a complete world that is problem-free, that is loss-free. And that literally is actually what we really want. Okay. So we're going in that direction. And does that make us terrible people? No, it does not. Because keep in mind, as I've said many times, that there is no loss in reality. Nothing's lost. There is no scarcity. Everything is already harmonized. Everything is already one. There's no want. There's no sickness. There's no choice. There's no loss. No dying, no death, no sickness. Only endless delight. That is reality. That is what we are. And we're entitled to that. That is our birthright. That is our inheritance. And we're trying to forget that. We're trying to be prime creator. In order to do that, we have to believe we can separate cause and effect. Okay, so we dream this scenario of loss. We have the desire to change what we are, which means we have to lose what we are. So the effort to change loss within this desire to change what we are, which causes this loss scenario, to look at all these effects of loss in existence, and to say, I need to change all these effects, is literally to attempt to separate cause and effect. It literally is. So all those do-gooders, they may seem like they're wonderful people, but the purpose of what they're doing is ultimately to try and separate cause and effect. So the cause does not have the effect. It's the cause and effect are not one, don't not share the same purpose. Okay, trying to get a different person to distance. And if they can be able to accomplish that, then it will literally be the power then to separate spirit from prime creator. Give spirit a different purpose than what the prime creator gave to spirit. So they are really egoic. They are 100% trying to accomplish the purpose of separation. Those who are trying to experience a loss-free world, a perfect, flawless world, that's always been free of loss of any kind, always will be, they are giving up the desire to be prime creator, giving up the desire to separate cause and effect, giving up the desire to to give a different purpose to the effects of a cause. They're relinquishing that. They're repenting. They're the ones who are dropping the ego. Okay. So very different than what the world tells you, right? Very, very different than what the ego tells you. The ego will tell you, you know, you need to, you know, fix everything. This will transform it, and on and on, as we've just spoken about. And the ego says that those who are simply sitting in satsang and maybe in a very peaceful place, bubble here, and trying to accept a single purpose, which is to realize that you need to choose a different idea. Idea of not trying to be prime creator, and then experience the effects of that idea, which is the loss for the world. The ego says that, you know, we're the ones who are selfish. What we're really doing is we're going back to the self that God created, instead of trying to create a new self, which is total arrogance. So we're not the arrogant ones. It's not arrogant to return to what we are. It is arrogant to continue to try and assert that we can change what we are, separate, give a different purpose to effects other than what the cause is. Now, of course, we do this, those who are trying to give a different purpose to existence, they try to forget what the cause was. They are unaware of it. So that's how they think that they're innocent. You know? What they're doing is fine. But if they saw what the cause of existence is, then they would know that what they're trying to do is they're trying to separate cause and effect, give a different purpose to the effects. They would know it. They would see it. And then at that point, they say, well, wait a minute. Maybe this is not such a great thing that I'm doing. Okay, and then wisdom starts coming to their life. So being in a very wonderful, beautiful place where they're not engaged in trying to solve the problems of the world is actually a step closer towards allowing the light of the problem-free, the loss-free world to reach us. Getting closer to accepting a single purpose. Okay, not trying to give two purposes to effects, or not trying to change the purpose, but saying one purpose to effects. I'm willing to just have a cause to have one purpose. I'm willing to have one with the purpose of the cause. Single purpose. So that's reality. Reality is always single purpose. Even the idea of trying to transcend reality is still single purpose. It's trying to get rid of reality. Single purpose. Can't have two purposes. We're trying to give it a second purpose. That's called dualism. Dualism is the belief that we can have two purposes, but ultimately the aim of dualism is to give it a new purpose. So dualism is just kind of a temporary compromise. We say, well, we haven't been able to give it a new purpose yet, so let's just say we'll give it two purposes. And then we have this blend, you know, of stuff that we're trying to be spiritual, we're trying to be a spiritual path, we're trying to be do-gooders, we're trying to do it all, you know, do it all. Satisfy both purposes. That just drives us crazy. Causes insane stress. Shift over here. I don't know how this is going to go. Let's make a shift. Let's try it. Are we there? Are we here? Okay. Well, I don't know if the audio is smooth or not here. Hopefully it'll smooth out. So, okay, we just made a shift. Okay? Pretty smooth. Pretty smooth shift here. This video, interestingly enough, is actually a composite. It's actually two videos blended into one to give this sort of surrealistic effect here, which I actually did that. B- But it's apropos of what we're talking about, is we cannot blend the problem-free world with the problematic world. We cannot blend our desires to fix, harmonize, transform, bring peace, progress, etc. to a world, and at the same time experience a world that needs none of that, because it already is that. I can't do that both, so maybe this video right here somehow triggered this satsang. It's actually a picture of sunset in Fiji. A video of sunset in Fiji, and also a video of waves breaking on a West Coast beach somewhere. West Coast of the United States, probably. Or maybe Hawaiian beach. That's sunset. Sunset in Fiji. And there's a bay there. You see these waves breaking the sea. It's very creative, right? But there is no creativity that can resolve this problem that we're talking about here. And that is, we cannot see a world that has no problems and still carry this complex of needing to solve problems in order to somehow establish our identity and be happy. You see, most of the teachings of the world, including the religious, spiritual teachings of this world, ethical and moral teachings, teaches that we, in order to experience happiness, we need to solve problems. We need to be very good people that solve other problems. That's what we're taught. That's what we're told. And so we have this massive complex, guilt complex, that we're not doing enough. We're not happy because we haven't solved enough problems. We go out there and feed all the starving people of the world and heal all sicknesses and make everybody else happy before we can be happy. We need to solve all the environmental problems of the world. And then what we find out is that we have to solve all the problems of the universe. It never ends. In order to be happy. So we have this immense do-gooder complex, believing that we must do all this stuff in order to be happy, in order to experience our true identity, in order for God to smile upon us. And yet, so how can we bring this complex, this do-gooder complex, and have a vision of the real world at the same time, a world that is completely problem-free, that reminds us of reality? That's what this world is, the real world. Shines in our awareness and shows us that reality is truly problem-free. We have all our dreams of problems and loss, and that touch reality. And we have to be shown that. It's the only way back. We have to be assured that this is so. Otherwise, the terror of jumping back into functioning the way we were created to function in reality is too strong, because our belief and faith will conjure up this terror for us. So we need to see a free world first. And how can we see that if we have this do-gooder complex? We have this guilt complex. I had a terrible complex, feeling that I had to literally solve all the problems of the world before I could experience happiness. And since I wanted to experience happiness so bad, I set about trying to solve all the problems of the world. By thinking, trying to come up with some plan. And my thinking simply got out of control. I wouldn't stop. So I couldn't sleep anymore because I couldn't find the plan. You see, he said, how am I going to solve all problems? He said, I have to do it because I want to be happy. And so my mind just started going faster and faster and faster. My thoughts were just like warp speed, millions of thoughts just flowing through my mind nonstop. And I'd close my eyes at night, and exactly, and it wouldn't stop at all. In fact, it'd go faster. I'd just sit there watching this parade of thoughts streaming by. All these thoughts are desperately, purposefully working to come up with a way to solve the problems of the world. And the only way that I was able to survive this, because I couldn't sleep at all. So I went, decades with very little sleep, which caused my immune system to run down, and I began to be constantly ill with the sickness that came around. I had nonstop colds and flus and suffering of various types. And no immune system was so weak because I was exhausted and too stressed out. The only way I got out of that was to begin to wake up to truth and begin to see the trap that I had fallen into, and to realize you cannot have two opposite purposes at the same time. You either see one or the other. And what really saved me was A Course in Miracles. That really actually saved my life. I would have been dead a long time ago if I had not come across true teaching that pointed out what the problem really is and what the solution really is. And then I saw it and I said, oh my gosh, this is true. But how am I going to educate myself from all this falsity, you know? And we're all in the same boat, really. I just wanted to get there faster. I wanted to reach happiness now. So I thought I had to solve all the problems of the world right now. So I got my mind got activated, you know, right now. And some people simply who are saying, well, I have to solve all the problems of the world, but I'm going to spend like, you know, a couple hundred years doing it. So they have less stress. Their mind isn't, you know, the mind is thinking about it, but it's not revved up to the point where it thinks it has wants to solve the problems today. It says, I'm going to work on it for a couple of years. So they're able to sleep. People are able to sleep. In my case, I could not. It was horrible. But now we find out the truth of the situation. We literally cannot take the do-good complex. We cannot have the do-good complex and the vision of the real world, the problem-free world, at the same time. Impossible. Possible. That will cause us to be terrorized. We would think that we're being completely attacked in some sneaky way that we cannot fathom. We think that we're having some horrible dream, literally. That is what would happen if the vision of the real world dawned on our awareness. What is this? What is going on here with this video? Wow. Very interesting. Huh. If the vision of the real world dawned on us, we would feel as if we suddenly had been plunged into severe dreaming. Some incredibly strange, bizarre dream that suddenly arisen. That's what we think. That's what we believe. And we'd be terrified. We'd say, oh my gosh, what is this dream I'm dreaming? I'm hallucinating. I'm having some kind of out-of-body experience or dream. And we'd seek to squelch this dream. We'd say, I want to get back to reality. I want to get back to this world without problems so I can work on solving them, so I can work on finding myself. And we'd see this dream as just a nightmare. That's literally true. So when anyone asks, well, how come we can't see this real world, the problem-free world? I've just laid out why we can't see it. Because it would freak us out. Most of us, it would freak out. The purpose of sad song is to get to the point where it doesn't freak us out at all, where we actually welcome it with open arms and say, ah, finally I'm seeing a reality-based dream, as it were, and I am waking up from this horrible dream of getting rid of reality. Exchanging one dream for another, but it's a very happy exchange, because I know that then this dream will easily translate itself back into reality, whereas the dream of getting rid of reality does not translate itself back into reality at all. There is no gentle translation from that at all. All we have is it would be just an abrupt leap, but not a gentle translation at all. Is this audio being picked up? Okay, I think it is. If you're speaking loud enough too. I know the background is a little loud. I'm trying my best here to illustrate some things. Let me see if I can go back to this. I don't know if I can shift back here. Let me try it. Could be some problem here. Hold on. Bear with me. Okay? All right, very good. We're still here. This. So the satsang, the purpose is to get to the point where we're not freaked out by the vision of the real world. By the light of the problem-free world, of this dream that is full of problems, this light, we can become aware of it. But it will not force itself upon us. If we will be freaked out by this and think that there's some crazy dream that came out of nowhere and we'll start hallucinating, it won't present itself to us a lot. Because it's based on love. Okay. And it will wait until we accept it. We accept a single purpose. We realize that causes have a single purpose and we're not trying to split the purpose. Okay? Because if we have this vision, we're trying to split the purpose. We try to split it between being problem-free, and therefore having no need to solve anything, and between that and trying to solve all sorts of problems. How can we split it between these two? We can oscillate back and forth. It is horrible, horrible. And so will not present itself to us under those conditions. We have to have a single purpose. We can say, my single purpose brings the problem-free world to my awareness, and only that willingness to have a single purpose. So all we're doing is we're talking about this. We're not forcing the vision on anyone. It cannot be forced on anyone. Nobody can give you this vision, okay? It cannot be given to you. The problem for the world gives itself to you. It gives itself to you when you are willing to accept single purpose for effects. No teacher, no guru, no savior, no sage. Nobody can give this to you. They can't give you, boom. How would you say, boom, Shaktipat. There's the Shaktipat in you. Boom. Real world, problem-free world. I gave it to you. I got the power. I got the right hat, and I'm wearing the right Shakti hat, and I'm giving you the power. It cannot do that. Cannot do that. That's ludicrous. We're not going in that direction at all here. The most any guru can do is accept it for themselves and then reassure you it's there and explain to you what the conditions are for you to receive this vision. That's the most any teacher can do. So it will never be forced upon you. I had the experience in a dream and I was happy with it for a while, and then I started getting a little jittery. But it was necessary. I was willing to experience it for just a little bit, you see, just to be sure it was there. And then I kind of got out of it. And since then, I've been working on removing those jitters. And that's what we do in satsang. That's what you're doing right now. You're removing the jitters by seeing what's causing the jitters. What causes the jitters is you're thinking, oh my gosh, how can I have two purposes for this vision? How am I going to handle that? How am I going to manage it? And it becomes a management problem, doesn't it? It becomes a management problem, and you're thinking, this is too much. I don't think I can manage this. And you start getting nervous, and you start thinking, I need to really have a plan to manage this. And I start thinking a lot, and then you can't sleep, and get worried, stressed out. And you say, I forgot my management plan. And then you wake up in the morning and say, okay, I think I'm ready to experience the robbery world. And you say, wait a minute, okay, what was my plan? Had some really good plan, how to manage, how to experience problem freeness and at the same time keep working on solving the problems. But now I kind of forgot about it. I'm not sure it's going to work. And then, so you back away, your intentions back away like that. And every day is like that. Every day is like that. You want to experience problem free experience, but you're wondering how can you also keep experiencing problems so you can keep trying to solve them. Therein lies the problem, right? Every day. That is everyday life, everyday problem along the spiritual path. The spiritual path is very frustrating because every plan we come up with, it never works. Yeah, and we keep forgetting, saying, I can't quite remember. I thought I might have figured out how to do it, but now I've forgotten. The answer is it can't be done. You cannot have two purposes. You have to agree to a single purpose. You have to be willing to realize that all causes have a single purpose. No such thing as a cause that has a dual purpose. Really, it's not like we can have this cause and say, I want to experience reality, and at the same time, I want to experience the rejection, denial of reality. You cannot do that. You cannot serve two masters like that simultaneously. You have to serve one or the other. I think that's why Jesus says you can't serve two masters. If you try, you'll be faithless to both. That's true. You'll be in a state of insanity to serve both. Right? And that's why some people talk about the spiritual path, they're afraid of. They say, oh, no, I had this experience, you know, that really caused it to imbalance me and destabilized me. Yeah, because, you know, they for a minute maybe they said, okay, I have a single purpose, and I'll experience a problem-free world, which if we choose a single experience, we'll experience the problem-free world. Because our problem is we think we can have two purposes. We can separate. In other words, we give ourselves, spirit, a different purpose than what God gave us. You see? So if we're willing for a moment to have a single purpose, we will then experience a problem-free experience. You know, people will say, wow, this is bliss, this is nirvana, this is samadhi, this is enlightenment, self-realization. I had this glimpse of heaven, of paradise, of perfection. And then they'll try and integrate that into, they'll say, how can I use this experience to motivate me to solve the problems of the world better? Can I use it to, one, be more intelligent and purposeful and motivated, you know, to solve the problems of the world? So they use it then to try and do the very thing that this experience was meant to free them from. And that's life. That's a spiritual path. That's the troubles that everybody has. We all suffer from the same problems. They come up in different symbols, you know, different ways, but it's all based on the very same thing, very same problem. We have a glimpse, and then we say, okay, great, I know I can be happy, so now let me go full bore on solving the problems of the world so I can reach that happiness. And what happens then is, of course, they cause stress out. So it's very important. Walnut just fell on the roof. the squirrels are busy getting the walnuts now. It's very important that there are teachers in the world who stress this. So that those who've had a glimpse, for a moment they chose, okay, I'll have a single purpose. They get a glimpse of reality, of the dream that translates itself into reality. It's perfect, perfection. They then use this to try and motivate themselves to solve the problems of the world. And they end up in severe depression and stress. It's very important, teachers, who point this out. What's really going on? What's really happening? If you just hear this, if someone just hears this, what's being said, like here, for instance, the light's going to go off in their mind and say, oh my gosh, there really is a way that I can be saved from this horrible, torturous situation that I'm in, that I'm trying to do, save solve the problems of the world, I'm trying to use this experience I had at perfection, and I'm getting nowhere, I'm killing myself from the stress of it all, I feel trapped, I don't see how to get saved from this. And then they hear, you know, this type of satsang, and they say, oh my gosh. Oh my gosh, I see. I am going to be able to get free. I will get free. No doubt about it. And I had this exact experience from A Course in Miracles. When I read it, I immediately said, oh my gosh, I am going to get free. I know 100% for a fact. Because what is said in here is accurate and truthful, and it shows the way to get free. And it can come in different ways. You know, I'm just using my own verbiage and clarity to speak. I'm not holding A Course in Miracles here, you know, and reading it for you. You know, don't need to, because it's the principle is always the same. You can be expressed in different ways, but the same principle in different. People enjoy different verbiage, you know, at different times. Verbiage changes, so it's helpful to have it expressed in different ways. We don't need a monolithic expression. We don't need everybody to be, you know, another religion where everyone says, read the Course. there's line six, you know, three, line six, and, you know, da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da, and everybody goes there, and every, around the world, everybody reads the same verse on the same day, and, you know, as they do in Catholicism, everyone is having the same readings from the Bible, from Scripture, and then from the New Testament, and then from Jesus' words, and then there's a homily. It's set around the whole world. Everybody's having the same readings, and it's the basically the same. The words are the same for everyone. That's not needed. We don't need to establish a religion. What we need to do is have those who get clear and get free and have a single purpose, and then reassure others that this is it. This too, and they're able to express it in their own words, in their own way, and many situations then begin developing, many satsangs develop, where people are reassured and they're on the path quickly, because now they know now, just like I did, oh my gosh, there is a way to get free of this horrible dilemma, the sleeplessness, this mind that is out of control, this feeling I gotta solve the problems of the world. I now see the mistake I made. I made a mistake. I've been deluded. And it's just a matter of time before I get free of it. And then when he gets motivated to study and to listen to him and to clarify, that's how it really works. The verbiage is pretty simple. And the situation is very, very simple. It's completely basic, actually. And it can be pointed out very simply. Very basics. Very basically. Just the basics, all we have to hear. And, you know, some people, you know, will hear it one way, other people hear it another way. Maybe thousands of millions of different ways that they hear it. But it's all pointing to exactly the same situation. Must choose single purpose. Okay? Single purpose is what will bring a vision of Christ, a vision of the real world, the vision of the problem-free world, the vision of the perfect world, the vision of unconditional love, the vision of multidimensionality, vision of peace. It will bring that which is problem-free. You'll become aware of it. You'll perceive it. Your awareness will be perceiving problem-free scenario, problem-free dream, which then, when we abide in that problem-free dream, this easily translates back into reality, which has been problem-free eternally and will always be problem-free eternally. And we'll translate into our easy acceptance of this and then functioning the way we're created to function. Full multidimensionality. Full spontaneity. Complete spontaneity. No concern. No worry. Absolute being in essence. We'll translate to that. But we don't need to worry about that translation. We simply need to focus on single purpose, showing, allowing the light of problem-free world to extend to our awareness, and then to abide in that experience and not think that we need to use this experience to motivate us to solve the problems of the world, because that then results in terrible stress, whoever does that. So, you know, the spiritual path, it all works out the right way for everybody, even though a lot of suffering comes about. Especially bad, though, it's especially important to free oneself from the teaching of the world, of those who are teaching we're supposed to transform this world. Very important. Because that puts an enormous guilt trip. And then when you listen like to this satsang, and maybe you can get a glimpse of the problem for your world, maybe in sleep or in your dreams, and then you'll have this also this other teaching telling you're supposed to transform the world and heal the world, and then you're going to think, oh my gosh, I feel so energized and confident now from this dream of perfection that I can go out and do that. You're then going to be immersed in this, you know, stress. So I have to point out how important it is to wean yourself away from teachings that are pointing you in the wrong direction of transformation, change, transformation, healing, fixing, solving, distributing, coordinating, unifying, harmonizing, all of these wonderful ideas. Anything that talks about changing the world in any way, you've got to back away from that, because that is not the answer at all. As we've seen, that is literally what prevents you from being saved. Because you cannot serve two purposes. And if you have that as your purpose, you will not be able to see the real world, the problem free world. And if you oscillate between the two, you're really going to have problems. And if you allow those who are talking about world transformation, allow them to dictate to you and set your agenda and put the guilt trip on you, you are going to suffer terribly. And I'm here to tell you that you are absolutely entitled to turn away from that kind of teaching. Absolutely entitled to it. It's absolutely the right thing to do. And it's the only way you're going to truly get free. Because I have experience in this. I had terrible guilt trips put on me by so-called spiritual teachers who were teaching that I was supposed to join them in trying to, you know, change the world, solve the world's problems, heal the world, transform the world. And that if I didn't join with them to do this, that I was demonstrating my unworthiness to be saved. That I was somehow leaving the oneness that I would be experiencing as I join with them in their mission to save the world, transform the world, that somehow I would be leaving that and somehow diminishing the effectiveness of that and hurting everyone and all this kind of horrible guilt trips. I had that laid on me. And fortunately, I was able to back away from it and saying, intuitively I said, you know what, I don't think this is it. I was literally saved by a dream of Ramana Maharshi. Ramana Maharshi came to me in a dream. I didn't know who it was during the dream. I only found out later, about a year later, looking on the internet, I saw a picture of him when he was young. And I said, oh my gosh, that's exactly who I saw in this dream. And Ramana came to me in the dream, and I was very depressed. And he came up to me, and he said, I've been watching what you're doing. I see what you're doing very perfectly clearly. And I love what you're doing. And he said, keep doing it, because one day it's going to be extremely helpful. And don't worry that nobody's paying any attention at all. Don't worry about that. I'm telling you, you're doing the right thing. I love what you're doing, and it's just as valid as what I said, what I've said. It's just as valid. It's just a slightly different verbiage and style. But keep at it, keep at it, keep at it. And then he walked away. During the whole time, he had the most incredible, reaffirming, loving presence that I've ever experienced, really. You know, just the kindest being you ever could ever meet. I just said, wow, whoever this was, they're just the nicest person I ever hoped to ever meet. And that literally saved my life, because I then had the courage to shed the guilt that these other so-called spiritual teachers were trying to lay on me to help them succeed with their mission of healing the world. You see, a lot of spiritual teachers believe they have to heal the world, and they try to recruit everybody to help them do this. And what they really are doing is they think that if they're at the head of a mission to solve the world's problems and they succeed, that they will get enlightened. And they tell the rest of the beings, you know, who are doing it, that somehow when they're enlightened, they'll pull everyone else into the enlightenment with them. But they're really trying to reach their own enlightenment this way, and just using others to reach this. And so, of course, to make a guilt trip on others, if others, you know, refuse to serve them, or, like in cults, if somebody decides to leave, then they lay this horrific guilt trip on whoever leaves. They say, if you leave, you're dead to us. We'll give you the silent treatment. You're like, you never existed to us, and we'll lose all your friends, and we will hate you forever. You know, just they try to just scare the dickens out of you if you leave this cult, because all these cults are trying to solve the problems of the world. They're not engaged in true satsang at all. So you have every right to leave any situation like that. Every right. And you have every right not to feel any guilt about it at all. You have every right to wake up and say, wait a minute, this is just the ego's plan of salvation, which will never work. Never work. And you know, you say, you heard this satsang, and you say, I've heard it. I know for sure there is a way. Single purpose. Not two purposes. It's experiencing a world that doesn't need to be saved. That's the way. The only way. Is no, I can get there. I finally agree to a single purpose. And so this way of trying to solve the problems of the world and also experience a problem for the world, can't do both. Cannot do both. Impossible. I have to choose one or the other. So at least that puts you in a place of saying, okay, I have to choose one or the other. That's a very good place to be. Very good place to be. I have to choose one or the other. And from that point, you break the hold of the ego upon you. Because you're evaluating which to choose. Instead of trying to do both. Okay? As long as you're trying to do both, you are literally in the clutches of the ego and you will fall prey to all sorts of unscrupulous egomaniacs who are trying to use you to help them reach some exalted spiritual condition. But as soon as you realize you have to choose one or the other, then you're no longer trying to do both, then you're in inquiry. Okay? You're in inquiry. When you're in inquiry, you develop some protection against these unscrupulous teachers. Really. Even the heavyweights. You know, there have been some big shot unscrupulous gurus in this world. And they really were very intimidating. Because they made a severe guilt trip. Because they said, if you're not with me, if you're not part of my world-saving mission, you're missing the boat, and you will pay the price, and you will not be included in our quote-unquote ascension or whatever. Sorry to say that, these are the facts. They claim that, you know, if you join with them in their world mission, bringing peace to the world and all this great stuff, that you will be part of this ascension that will take place and you'll be free from, you know, you get the glory. Not true. Not true. That's not how you get the glory. Get it by choosing a single purpose, realizing I can only have a single purpose. And then the real world that doesn't need any fixing, it doesn't need any healing, that is immaculate. That is so beautiful, immaculate, you just, oh my gosh, this is what I want. This is what I really want. You get that when you choose a single purpose. So right now, we're trying to decide which one to choose. You know, should I heal the world or choose a world that doesn't need healing? And in listening to this, you're literally overcoming your vulnerability to trying to do both, which leaves you vulnerable to these various cults, etc., exploitive situations, which is a great thing. You know, a lot of us have been through those kind of situations in various ways. Really, it's been horrible. You know, really the teachers in this world who really were very unscrupulous, and it was very tough, very tough. Because you feel some sort of attraction to their charisma. You know, they have some kind of Shakti charisma or something. And you're kind of thinking, wow, maybe I'm missing the boat here, you know, and feeling like really torn apart and split. Like, I want to join this, but it doesn't seem quite right. But if I don't, I feel like I miss something great, and they seem to be capable of this. I got all this spiritual charisma, and I get my intuition to say no, my ego saying yes. And, you know, it's horrible, horrible, horrible. You know, and fortunately, you know, most of the time I said no. But it was still tempting. No question about it. The world always has these types with all this spiritual charisma. And they have these big organizations around them that make it seem like, hey, you know, we're here, we're capable. Just everyone joins us, we'll solve all the problems of the world. And I was helped greatly by Ananda Maima, who absolutely had zero interest in saving the world, this world at all. She had no interest in building temples, schools, hospitals, doing anything. Wasn't interested in healing people, really. changing anything. She wasn't interested in political change, economic, social change. She wasn't interested in doing anything, changing this world in any way. She said, actually said very kindly, you know, look, you need to give that up. You need to give it up. You know, politicians would come to her and say, you know, what do I need to do here? I need to be a better politician. I need to help people. I need to change. And he said, you know what? Why don't you just drop all that and come to a satsang? And that's not the way. So they said, well, you know, I don't think I could do that because my people need me. My people need me. They're counting on me to solve their problems. And she'd just say, yeah, well, that's your karma. But don't involve me in that. She was invited many times to for a preeminent position in India by the head honchos. And she just turned them down and said, no, no thank you. No thank you. Forget it. No, I got no interest in that. So seeing that, I said, wow, you know, here's somebody who could be put on a pedestal as the champion for social change, for social justice, for healing the world. They literally said, we'll put you on the highest pedestal and serve you. Leaders of India said, we'll put everyone in India at your disposal if you're just willing to take the figurehead position. And we will lead the world we'll save the world, we'll heal the world, we'll all the problems of the world if you will just agree to be the figurehead and tell us what to do. And she said, no thanks, no way. Sorry, but I'm not going to do that. No interest in that. That's not what I'm here for. So seeing that, you know, it's like, she was offered, you know, the top position in the world, really, to be the new world savior. And she said, I had no desire for that whatsoever. And she said, that's not it. That's delusion. That's maya. That's ego. And so I saw that, and I said, holy cow, you know, that's great teaching. That isn't just words. That is action. She took the right action. Yeah? Imagine if the president and the head of the UN and everyone, all the dignitaries of the world came to you and said, we're going to make you the top figurehead in the world. And if all the world, countries of the world, we're going to worship you and we're going to do whatever you tell us to do, we're going to do it. We've got the power, we've got the organization, we've got the will, and by doing this, you are going to be the savior of the whole world. Imagine if you had that lady at your feet, you know, and you could just dismiss it like nothing, like it's nothing. That's what, you know, she had that. So I was helped by that. Yeah, I saw that and I said, wow, if she says that, that's how it is, I'm going to believe that, you know. I believe it. She says, don't spend your time building more temples. Spend your time in spiritual inquiry. Coming to single purpose, vision of oneness. Okay, single purpose brings vision of oneness, brings the awareness of the real world to you. And she said, she would say, everything's already perfect. She says, what I see, everything's already perfect. Why should I try to change anything? Everything's already perfect. And that's what she was seeing, literally. She didn't see any reason to change anything. Karmically, there were some. She makes some adjustments if it would lead to satsang. Yeah. You know, the guru has the wisdom to do that if it fits. But that's a different story. So you must be able to extricate yourself from the entrapments of the world saviors who say they're here to save the world. The world doesn't need saving. You need saving from the world. You need saving from the crazy mad idea that you can give a different purpose to an idea, to a cause. You must be safe from the crazy whim of trying to be prime creator. Okay. You must be safe from that. Your goal is not to save the world, it is to be saved from the world. How do you be saved from the world? By seeing another world that doesn't need to be saved. That's how. And of course, you will not go down in the annals of history, world history, as a world savior, will you? Just like Ananda Mayawa right now has been lost and forgotten by almost everybody. Nobody knows of her now. Why? because she didn't accept the position of world savior. She says, what is there to save? Everything is already perfect. Nothing to save. You just need to see the perfection. That's all. And she wasn't saying that this world here doesn't have, you know, loss and suffering. She's saying that the vision of Christ, the vision of the real world, the real world is there for you. It's there for you. The perfect overlay here. Single purpose will bring it to you. So we do need to extricate ourselves. We do need to be adamant about that. And we extricate ourselves again by realizing we have to choose one or the other. That's the first step. And it takes us a while to decide which one to choose. Should we choose the ego's purpose of loss, or the purpose of remembering what we are? Should we choose to forget what we are or to remember what we are? We can't do both at the same time. Should we try and solve the problems of the world or see a world that doesn't have any problems? One or the other. So as soon as we realize it's one or the other and we start working on that, we are literally on the true path of salvation, liberation, self-realization. All of that, we're on the true path, and we won't be sidetracked very much. The sidetracking will be a lot less severe. And even the heavyweight scoundrels who come here and try to enlist us to help them, we will even not be tempted by them. Think about that. We'll be able to say, yeah, thanks, but no thanks. I'm not going to be part of that. We'll literally be able to do that, which is pretty fabulous. You know, I'm able to do that, so I can tell you, yeah. You know, some people ask me, what about this teacher? What about that teacher? Et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And I'm not interested. Not interested. Not interested in saving the world. Not interested in joining a world-saving movement, a world-saving religion, a world-saving guru. Not interested in developing psychic powers so I can save the world. Because I know salvation is completely simple. Single purpose. Just decide, okay, let me experience single purpose. That automatically will bring the vision of the problem-free world, automatically. And then that automatically gets translated into reality when we're used to abiding in that. It's that simple. It's that simple. The world as it is right here remains untouched. It remains the problematical world for those who are desperate to try and solve those problems. There's nothing that the people of this world will get more upset than if the problems were somehow solved. They didn't have any problems, so they feel they'd be robbed of their opportunity to develop a self. They feel they'd be deprived of it. They would just, you know, freak out completely. So, of course, we cannot solve the problems of this world, because that would be against the laws of reality. And we would not solve them anyway, because we believe that our salvation rests upon solving the problems of the world. And if we see a world there's no problems there, we'll freak out. If all the problems in this world were banished, let's say, where can we go to develop ourselves? You know, we need a world with problems. We need sick people. You know, is there a doctor if there's no sick people? Is there a doctor? Are there therapists if there's no one suffering from any sort of conflicts? No, there's not. There's no doctor. There's no therapist in the world at all. Because there's no sickness. No conflict. So if one wants to be a doctor, thinking that is a way to develop some identity that'll eventually translate into happiness, then that doctor has to be in a place where there's patients, where there's sickness. It's a fact. Same with therapists. Same with anyone who wants to solve any problem whatsoever. They have to be in a place where those problems arise. Have to. And of course, that's why this world, you know, some will continue. This world itself is going to experience severe loss. But there are many, many dwelling places in the cosmos that present all sorts of problems for those who want to solve problems. And as long as one wants to solve problems, one will find oneself in a place with problems to be solved. And if one wants to accept single purpose, that single purpose is real, cannot have a dual purpose for a cause, and cannot change a purpose from one purpose to another, then they will experience a problem-free world, nirvana, para-nirvana. First one experiences nirvana, and that gets translated into para-nirvana, our reality. One experiences the dream of the world, the problem-free world, that gets translated into then reality. That's how it works, folks. So, I hope this has been very, very helpful. It's been helpful for me to clarify this and go over and over and over it, you know, so it sinks in. So it sinks in to, I go over and over and over things, be so you don't think that it was some just sort of like a glimpse that happened for a moment, that somehow I got a glimpse and that was all, and then it went back to awareness. Just like usually we have little breakthroughs, little glimpses, and then we get confused again and lose sight of it. And we think, oh, maybe that's all there is. These little glimpses, maybe that's all there is. Not true. So I keep going over and over and over it, so you see that it's clear. It's based on seeing it. I continue to see it. It's not just an insight that disappeared. You know, it's something that can be talked about and can remain clear to us. We can remain on point. We can remain on topic. Can be done. Can be done. If I were just to give you just a quick little insight, and that's it, then you would assume that that's the best you can do as well. It's not true. Not true. You literally expound upon this and go back again and again and again and again and get more and more clear and more and make progress, you know, towards it. And put your whole path into perspective and to see why you've had the troubles you've had. And to realize that you can be free of those troubles. You put everything into context, you know, and you say, aha. And then that gives you a lot of motivation. And you say, I'm not really stuck. I'm not just stuck with these little glimpses and insights. I can really have freedom from suffering and misery. And in fact, I will do that. So that's why these satsangs are longer. And why I keep saying it's extremely beneficial. Way more beneficial than like a 5-minute thing. Way more. Because you start to get the confidence that, hey, it's doable. It's really doable. I'm seeing it. Clearly, Ross is just going over and over and over and over and over and saying, you know, getting better and better, more and more clarity, and keeps touching on the same theme. And it's like, you know, the bee is buzzing all around here. The bee just stays right there. You know, it's still right there, right there, right there. It's not leaving the flower. You know, the flower's there. Bee is coming to the nectar, and the bee is saying, ah, I know the nectar is there, I know it's there, it's not there, I'm not leaving. It's like that. You can stay on the trail. What gets us off of it is we say, oh my gosh, I spent 5 minutes in satsang and I heard the truth, but I need to get back to my guru who's telling, and we got to go solve the problems of the world, so I got to spend most of my time doing that. We may not even have a guru, but we say, I need to get back to solving the problems of the world. So I better, you know, leave this satsang behind. Maybe I'll give it 2 minutes, 5 minutes, like, tops. But here, giving it more time. And boost the gain here. There we go. All right. We can keep going. Just keep boosting. Keep boosting the gain. There's a squirrel up there. Sending down nuts. Boom, boom, boom. All right. It's that time of the year, isn't it? They're having a feast. The squirrel's going to have a feast on the nuts. Let me see what I can do here. We can probably wind this down. still. Another warm evening. But it's actually going to cool off tomorrow. I can feel the coolness coming in. And we've taken another mega step forward. Mega step. And I'm finally saying the things that I really wanted to say in this world and putting them into the right context and explaining why I hold these, you know, views. Why I, you know, have tried to steer clear of a lot of spiritual teachers and why I felt they weren't teaching properly. Some do. Some teach properly. Some are on the other side of the spectrum. And you can't serve them both. Cannot do it both, right? Cannot have two opposing purposes. Simultaneously cannot see a problem-free world and still maintain the strong desire to solve a world full of problems. Cannot do that. And if you have two gurus, one that shows you that you cannot do it, and one that tells you you can, then of course you're going to be conflicted, really conflicted. And forget about all the displays of Shakti, you know, all the so-called miracles and all the pyrotechnics and the spiritual glamour stuff. Forget about it, it's nothing. Because Shakti, you know, the egoic energy, can produce all sorts of modifications in existence, all sorts of changes. Think, wow, you know, that guru's got a lot of power. You know, they're able to modify all that stuff and change all that stuff. And, well, they're able to heal somebody and all this kind of things. Forget about all of that. It's nothing. It has nothing to do with salvation. It just glamorizes the path of trying to solve the world's problems, trying to tell you that, hey, you too can develop these powers if you stay with this teacher will show you how to have these powers, and then you'll be like a super healer and a super fixer-upper and a super harmonizer and a super unifier and a super distributor and a super mood elevator and therapist, and you'll be super, super, super. If you're just as guru, stay with them and help them out, they will. What the guru does is they steal your energy and they use you to elevate themselves up into the eyes of the world, to try to gain even greater heights, more followers, more adherents, more worshipers, all of that. That's what they use you for. And if you decline their offer to do that, oh boy, they get really mad. They get really angry. I've experienced that a number of times. They act like you're depriving them of their salvation, you know. And they say you're the most selfish person in the world because I'm offering, giving you this tremendous offer. I'm giving you all this grace, this the unparalleled, unprecedented grace. Here I am, the world guru, the world savior. I'm giving you the opportunity to join with me in my mission of saving the world, and you turned it down. You must be the most egotistical maniac that ever was created, and you're never going to be saved. You're hopeless. You know, they put that trip on you. I've had that trip on me. And you know, almost killed me, really. The stress of that, really. The guilt was so severe, there was no emotional tone. But I said, you know, my intuition said, you know, no. And the grace of God threw obstacles in my path. So I really could not join up with anything like that. That guilt trip was really something. They believe that you are depriving them of their salvation. They just have no idea what salvation is. So they believe, and you know, their word against yours. And who are you to think that you see truth more clearly than some world-saving guru that's got, you know, hundreds of thousands of devotees saying that this is it? Who are you to say that you know truth better than they do? Which literally is what it boils down to. Because they believe that you're depriving them of salvation. They have a completely wrong idea of salvation. And it's your vision against theirs. And they say, look, nobody's following you. And everybody's following me. So how can you possibly assert that you must be right? Which is why that dreamer of Ramana Maharshi helped me so much. He said, look, I know nobody's following or listening to you or anything. I know a lot of people are falling out lately, so I said, yeah, I acknowledge that. I said, hey, I've been watching you, whatever you're doing, and it's fabulous, fabulous. And he said, don't let the pressure get to you. He says, I am aware of what you're doing. I say what you're doing is right. So listen to me. Forget about all those naysayers, who say that somehow you're depriving them of their salvation, or that your vision of it is wrong, or there's this right. So forget it. I'm saying your vision of it is right. Stick with it. Like I said, that saved my life, because these uber mega superstar gurus of the world were literally putting the pressure on me, saying, how can your vision be the right and mine wrong, when you don't have anyone saying you're right, and I have, countless spiritual devotees and dakinis and sannyasis and all these beautiful spiritual people coming to me and saying that I'm right. How can you say I'm not right? That's crazy. You must be out of your mind. You must be a wicked person. You must be all this stuff. That's the pressure I was under. And so in the back of my mind, I said, well, this beautiful, wonderful soul who's so much more kinder than you are came to me and said, what you're doing is right. I believe and trust in what you're doing. Stick with it. So I'm going to go with them more than I'm going to go with you. That's how it worked out. And I said, I'm going to go with another mind instead of what you're saying. I'm going to go with the Course in Miracles instead of what you're saying. So those three influences, the Course in Miracles, another mind, enabled me to stand up to those uber, super, universal guru saviors who insisted that they were teaching must be right, and that whatever I was thinking, by not joining with them, it couldn't possibly be right. It just must be crazy. So I stood up to them and said, no, forget it. I'm going to stick with what I'm doing. So the great teachers really do help us, Even though we don't even meet them in the flesh, even though all that, still, they are super helpful. Super helpful. And I didn't even ask them to come help me out. They found a way. They proactively showed up in my life in some way and say, do this, you need this, really, because, there were some tough cookies in this world. Trying to lead the world astray. Very tough cookies, I'll tell you that. And their delusion has been seen through, not through hatred, but through love and compassion. And I say to them, as soon as you choose single purpose, the vision of the world will be there for you, and you will experience this perfect delight and bliss too. You're not damned, nobody's damned. Even those who try to lead the world astray are not damned. The real world, as soon as they accept single purpose, that will automatically bring problem-free experience to them, too. It just may take them a while, to get out of their spiritual egotism. Or maybe not. Maybe they just realize, that was really stupid. I understand why I did that, I realize it doesn't work, so let's do what works. It's equally possible. Equally possible. But what they may say is, they've been working on this for billions of years, trying to save the universe, and here they are, come to this planet, and they've almost completed. This is the story. Okay, and they say, they've come to this planet, and this is the last place, and just we heal this planet, the whole universe will be healed. And they say, all we need is the top spiritual teachers of this planet to join with the guru, this great guru, and by joining with them in the mission, they will then be able to heal the entire planet, and by doing that, the entire universe will be healed, and everything will be in bliss, and it's all over. And so how can you stand up to that, that narrative, which is what they give? Because you think, oh my gosh, they've been working at this in billions of years, and they're just one step away from accomplishing it. And they need me to help them accomplish it. How can I turn that down? Wow, it's just like almost impossible to turn that down. And if you turn it down, you really literally feel that you are preventing the entire universe from being saved. That's the pressure that this world's been under. That's why so many are still not tuning in to real satsang, whether here or with some others that are talking about single purpose and how to truly be saved, because they're still feeling some guilt, and their focus is still so much on, let's complete this great guru's mission, and we just have to, heal this world, make it a fair place. If we do that, the whole universe is going to be saved. They're still working on that. And it's very tough to realize that, because they think if they give it up, they're causing the whole universe to fail. The whole universe is depending on what happens here. That is the ultimate scam. It is the ultimate spiritual scam. And this world got hit with that real hard. My only regret is I didn't speak up earlier. I just didn't have the nerve to do it, thinking I would be, wiped out. Some incredible backlash. I haven't received it, I've been speaking up more and more, and hasn't coming, and just have to thank all the listeners here for being so supportive, It's been tremendous, because I literally expected, just unbelievable, terrible backlash from those who have been following these, various quote-unquote world saviors and trying to save the world, and here they hear him saying, you don't need to save the world, that's the wrong approach, that's what saved you, and there's this other approach, and, they're likely to take that, like as if I'm attacking their salvation and actually causing the whole universe to fail, to be saved, so they're likely to be very angry about that, I'm thinking, and, some have been very angry, tell you the truth, not very many, but I have gotten some communications from some that were pretty extreme, to say the least. Pretty threatening, to say the least. I've soldiered on, because there are those out there, I can tell, that are hearing this, and they're being helped by it, and they don't feel threatened by what I'm saying at all. They just, okay, it's not, doesn't seem threatening. Seems like to hear this. And so I'm able to continue on, and I believe the tide has turned. I believe the tide has turned in this world. That just the fact that we're able to soldier on in this way, and to say what needs to be said, and waking up from this false path, that this puzzle, we don't need to stay trapped in it. We need to realize we just need to make a choice, one or the other. Which purpose do we serve? Not both. That's getting through. Somehow that's getting through. And at some deep level, people are saying, yeah, that's it. And I was distracted for a while on this severe guilt trip, that telling me that if I didn't go along with what the plans of these so-called saviors were, that I would be preventing the whole salvation of the entire universe. And God would, annihilate me for doing that. I'd be left behind. And that was a lie. That's a complete, total lie. And that there are teachers who have seen through this lie, advisors, holding satsang, and they've seen through this lie entirely. And they're not afraid to speak up about it. Not afraid to say, hey, yeah, this is what happened. This is what's going on. This is the truth. And you can be freed from delusion. And it's not a scary thing. It's an obvious thing. It's not contrary to reason. We're not, it's not attacking anybody. Those who want to continue to try and save, dwell in a problematical world, feel free to do so. We're not standing in their way. They will most certainly do that. Just as we will most certainly dwell in a problem-free world. As we're entitled to that. Because that's our choice. Right? Because reality supports that. Reality supports both those who want to dwell in a problematic world, and those who want to dwell in a problem-free world. Because spirit is free to choose whatever ideas it wants. And if spirit wants to choose the idea of trying to change what it is, it's free to do so. And if spirit wants to choose the idea of not trying to change what it is, it's free to choose that idea. Reality supports both ideas, both experiences. Just can't have both those experiences at the same time. That's impossible. It's impossible. Reality is not self-conflicted. Alright? It's not like prime creator created reality and said, yeah, I'm creating this, but I don't want to create it too. That's not it. that Frank entered and say, I created all the laws and reality and all this functioning of it, but I want to also oppose all the functioning and oppose all these laws. No, that's not it. Prime Creator didn't say, I created a flawless, invulnerable creation, but I also want to create a flawed, vulnerable creation at the same time and have it both simultaneously. No, didn't do that. Did not do that. Prime Creator didn't say, I want to be Prime Creator by having effects, but at the same time, I don't want to be Prime Creator by having no effects. Didn't do that. Prime Creator's not insane. It's not trying to cancel itself out. Just one truth, one direction, one reality, immaculate, pure, invulnerable, free. That's all there is. And this reality supports all expressions, all ideas, all experiencing. But it can't be canceled out. Okay. You know, you're free to try and throw your freedom away, but you cannot do it. You cannot actually bind yourself. You can imagine that it's possible symbolically, but you can't actually do it. You're free to try. You're free to try. You're free to imagine. But you can't actually do it. You're free to imagine the destruction of reality, but you can't actually do it. Reality cannot be harmed in any way. It cannot be changed in any way. So we're free to dream of reality changing, but it's just a dream. Can at the same time make it real, you know. And if you try to dream a dream, opposite dream, at the same time, what you end up is with total chaos. And we cannot sustain that at all. Cannot sustain it at all. We have to choose one or the other. Okay? And this dream we have that we can gradually transform the purpose of forgetting what we are, of changing what we are, gradually transform the effects of that into different effects, different purpose, and we do it gradually. That is delusion. That is Maya. That is the path of suffering. That's what drags us along through all the suffering, is the belief that somehow we can find some way to gradually transform existence. And then sometimes we grab hold of some heavyweight transformer, you know, supposedly, and they say, hey, join me now, we'll do it real fast. We'll do it real fast. Destroy. Cannot do it. Cannot do it. You're just going to end up in misery. Okay. So, there you go. There you go. That's a set of mouthful. How many? What time we got? One, 42. A set of mouthful. Let's see if we can shift over here. Let's see if we can do that. Still here? Okay. Very great. We will just go out on this very soothing, peaceful ocean sunset for this video. That's it.